Over in the U.S., the death toll from Hurricane Helene climbs to 89. Most of the casualties were from South Carolina. Meanwhile, damages estimated ranged from $15 billion to more than $100 billion. Massive cleanup and recovery efforts are underway. Helene knocked out power for millions, destroyed roads and bridges, and caused catastrophic flooding from Florida to Virginia. U.S. President Joe Biden assuring Americans the federal government is on top of the situation.
Yes, it's tragic. As a matter of fact, we're trying to get the exact number. My FEMA advisor is on the ground in Florida right now. There's a distinction between the numbers that FEMA's used and the ones that are used by the locals. So it really is amazing. You saw the photographs. It's stunning.
It's unbelievable. But
it really is.
So many, such a wide area.
And we've given them all everything that we have. We're on the ground ahead of time. So we're working hard.
Are there any more resources the federal government could be giving them?
No, we've given them. We have pre-planned a significant amount of it, even though they didn't ask for it yet. Hadn't asked for it yet.
Let's take a closer look at Helene's impact across southern U.S. states and on Filipino Americans from our Bureau Chief TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. One of the most powerful storms to hit the U.S. has left behind a trail of destruction in the southeast, causing death, massive power outages, and unprecedented damage.
Hurricane Helene wreaked havoc as the 14th strongest hurricane to hit anywhere in the U.S. since records have been kept, and the 7th most powerful to strike Florida, according to the National Hurricane Center. Search and rescue efforts are underway in 4 states, where more than 24 people have lost their lives. Helene made landfall as a Category 4 hurricane late Thursday. In the rural Bend area where Florida's Panhandle and Peninsula converge, with maximum sustained winds of 140 miles per hour. Heavy rain from Helene flooded parts of the southeast, including Georgia and the Carolinas. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis says Helene's destruction appears to be greater than the combined damage of Idalia and Hurricane Debby in August. Helene also left at least 4.5 million people in the dark.
I'm in the front of our house and I can hear some wind and the gust of the wind and the rain already. But I can't see anything because there's no street lights.
The National Hurricane Center says Helene had weakened to a tropical storm and was moving north across the southeast by Friday afternoon.
But many communities remain under evacuation orders or are inaccessible, with roads covered in water and debris. The Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, has deployed more than 1,500 workers, assisting with 400 rescues on Friday.
Made a lot of steps to ensure that there are areas now they can help the people. They've already requested the personal families in the low-lying areas near the coast to evacuate. And we have Filipino families that already have evacuated to safer grounds.
Michelle Riley rode out the storm at home with her kids.
For us who are here in the city, inland, we don't get those. It's an optional for us.
But Riley and other officers of the Big Bend Film Association are worried about fellow Filipinos.
We made contact with our members and we are ready tomorrow in case there's any problem. From sandbag distribution to maybe even tarps if needed para sa bagyo and all that rain. We're all just hoping and praying that it won't do so much damage.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at The Rundown.
Typhoon Julian wreaking havoc in northern Luzon with signal number 4 raised over Batanes and the northern portion of Babuyan Islands. Let's get an update now on the weather from Pagasa forecaster Veronica Torres. Good morning, Veronica. What do you have for us?
Good morning, Bettina, and to all of our audience at ANC. So as of 4 a.m. today, the center of the eye of Typhoon Julian was estimated based on all available data at the coastal waters of Balintang Islands, Calayan, Cagayan. So currently, Batanes and the northeastern Babuyan Islands is experiencing the violent winds as Julian continues to move over Balintang Channel. So It has maximum sustained winds of 155 kilometers per hour near the center and gustiness up to 190 kilometers per hour, moving westward with a speed of 10 kilometers per hour. And because of Julian, we have raised tropical cyclone wind signal number 4 over Batanes and the northern portion of Babuyan Islands. Signal number 3 over the rest of Babuyan Islands and the northeastern portion of mainland Cagayan. Signal number 2 over the rest of mainland Cagayan, Apayao, and Ilocos Norte, while signal number 1 is raised over Ilocos Sur, La Union, Pangasinan, Abra, Kalinga, Ifugao, Mountain Province, Benguet, Isabela, Nueva Vizcaya, Quirino, Aurora, the northern and eastern portion of Nueva Ecija. We also have released a weather advisory regarding the heavy rainfall caused by Tropical Cyclone Julian. So for today, we're expecting intense to torrential rains more than 200 millimeters over Batanes, Mabuyan Islands, and Ilocos Norte. Heavy to intense 100 to 200 millimeters of rains over mainland Cagayan, Ilocos Sur, La Union, Apayao, Abra, and Benguet. Moderate to heavy rains over Pangasinan, Zambales, Bataan, and the rest of Cordillera Administrative Region. We also have a gale warning raised over the seaboards of northern Luzon. And also, we're expecting Julian to leave the Philippine area of responsibility around Wednesday morning or afternoon. And that's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. Veronica Torres reporting.
Hi, Veronica. Just another question for you. Did the typhoon Julian, did it make landfall?
As of now, we're still analyzing the data and we're checking if it already made landfall over the islands of Batanes and Babuyan Islands. And then we'll give you an update if we have verified that it had made landfall.
All right.
But for today, there's a high chance of landfalling over Batanes, Babuyan Islands.
All right. And when it does make landfall, do we expect heavier rains in the Batanes area probably today within the day?
Yes, within the day, although it hasn't made landfall yet, we're still expecting heavy rains for today over Batanes, Babuyan Islands, and Ilocos Norte.
All right. Thank you very much for that update, Veronica. Several local government units have canceled classes for today, September 30, due to the bad weather. Now, here's a look at the list of class suspensions. Meanwhile, work in government offices are also suspended in Batanes until tomorrow, Tuesday, and in Ilocos Sur and La Union Monday. Turning now to the UN General Assembly in New York, the Philippines openly urging world leaders to give Manila a seat in the UN Security Council. In his speech, Foreign Affairs Secretary Enrique Manalo underscored the country's track record and commitment in upholding the rule of law. The primary responsibility of the UN Security Council is to maintain international peace and security. The last time the Philippines assumed one of its elected seats was for the term 2004 to 2005.
The Philippines stands alongside the pathfinders and bridge builders of nations. We offer constructive solutions across the spectrum of the work of the United Nations, from human rights, health, and humanitarian action to development, disarmament, and disaster and climate risk reduction, from peacemaking to peacemaking and peace building. As the first Asian republic and the founding member of the United Nations, our diplomacy has consistently pursued peace, the sovereign equality of states, the rights and dignity of all persons. The Philippines is a trusted partner, innovative pathfinder, and committed peacemaker. We bring experience, depth, and steadfastness in working with the international community to address common global challenges. We thus count on your support for our bid for a non-permanent seat in the UN Security Council for the term 2027-28.
Manila's top diplomat also condemning irresponsible actions in the West Philippine Sea. Manalo made no mention of any specific country, but his speech was delivered against the backdrop of China's continued aggression in the Philippine waters.
Despite irresponsible and dangerous actions against our legitimate activities within our own waters and exclusive economic zone, the Philippines remains committed to diplomacy and other peaceful means to settle disputes. We will abide by the UN Charter and the Manila Declaration on the peaceful resolution of disputes in asserting our sovereignty, our sovereign rights, and jurisdiction in the South China Sea. We do not accept narratives depicting the South China Sea as a theater of major power rivalry, because they all ignore what is an essential truth. All states in this region have a right to determine their own destiny and secure their own future.
Malaysia embracing a conciliatory tone on the South China Sea. Speaking at the UN General Assembly, Malaysian Foreign Minister Mohamed Hassan says the region must collectively pursue a different vision in which it is a zone of peace, stability, and cooperation.
We must adopt a collaborative approach embedded in diplomacy and dialogue. Thus, I call upon all countries to abide by the UNCLOS in the conduct of maritime governance. We must prioritize peaceful coexistence. This is also one of the many reasons the member states must continue to work together.
China claims almost the entire South China Sea despite overlapping claims in the busy waterway by Brunei, Malaysia, and the Philippines and Vietnam. Overseas Filipino workers in Lebanon urging the Philippine government to fast-track their repatriation. Some of the migrant workers aired their grievances over what they call a very slow process by concerned government agencies. There are over 11,000 documented OFWs in Lebanon, where tensions are rising between Israel and militant group Hezbollah.
Ako po'y nananawagan sa inyo na ma-rescue or matulungan po kami. Dahil hindi po totoo ang nilalabas ng DFA na marami po talagang ayaw umuwi, pero marami pong gustong umuwi na nahihirapan sa proseso. Dahil kapag dumudulog po kami sa ating embahada dito, pinapasahan po kami ng link para mag-fill up, which is pag tinatanong kung nasa ng passport namin, pag sinabi namin wala, kailangan daw pong kunin sa employer, which is ayaw naman po talaga ibigay ng mga employer.
Sa tagal ko na po dito sa Lebanon, hindi ko po naisipang umuwi. Pero ngayon pong sagipuhay na po kami rito, hindi na po pwedeng magtigil pa kami rito po. Nananawagan ako sa lahat ng ahirya ng gobyerno, bigyan naman po nila kami ng pansin. Hindi po pwedeng tutunga nga sila at maghintay kung kailan may flight mo. Huwag nila kahayaang may magbuwis ng buhay bago po sila kumilos.
The Migrant Workers Department earlier said the repatriation of over a dozen Filipinos in Lebanon has been rescheduled to October 3rd. They were supposed to be flown back home last Thursday, September 26, but several international airlines temporarily closed or rather suspended their flights amid increasing violence. As of September 15, over 400 OFWs have been repatriated from the conflict-hit nation. Israel strikes more targets in Lebanon Sunday after killing Hezbollah leader Sayyid Hassan Nasrallah and a string of its other top commanders. Israel's defense minister now discussing widening the offensive. Israel's stated goal is to make its northern area safe from Hezbollah rocket fire and allow thousands of displaced residents to return. But its strikes have also had a devastating impact on civilians in Lebanon. Lebanon's health ministry said more than 1,000 have been killed and 6,000 wounded in the past 2 weeks, without saying how many were civilians. The government also says 1 million people have fled their homes. Hezbollah fired a new barrage of rockets into Israel Sunday as it vows to avenge the death of its leader. The intensifying cross-border fire has increased fears the conflict could spin out of control, potentially drawing in the U.S., Israel's closest ally, and Iran. The U.S. military now increasing its air support capabilities in the Middle East and putting troops on heightened readiness to deploy to the region. The White House says the U.S. must be prepared for some sort of response from Tehran, even as it continues to urge a diplomatic resolution.
Well, their rhetoric certainly suggests they're going to try to do something. I mean, just coming out of Tehran, but we don't really know. We're watching this very, very closely to see how, if and how, Hezbollah and or Iran may react, as well as the militia groups in Iraq and Syria. We have to be prepared for some sort of response. We have to make sure that we are ready, and we are. We believe we have the force capability we need in the region.
Pope Francis condemns the use of force in Lebanon and Gaza as immoral. Responding to a question aboard the papal plane on flight back to Rome from Belgium, the pontiff insists countries cannot go over the top in using their military forces.
Ma la difesa sempre.